groovy people, welcome to the channel. This is the Blue Dragon bringing unto you the monthly Q&A, courtesy of my patrons at the $10 level or higher, also from my readers and viewers like you. As always, patrons get first dibs. Words of warning, my videos target an adult audience, and I don't support ads on my channel, that is, without choice or compensation, which I have neither on YouTube. We've got a variety of questions this month, and I'll try to get to them all. I will warn y'all, of late I've had a bit of an onset of a mental Word of Wednesday malaise. I'm sure it's just the quarantine taking its toll, that and stuff in my personal life bringing me a bit down. I'm not fishing for sympathy, but I do want to mention it in case you hear a lack of enthusiasm, which is very clear in my voice. It's just because I'm a bit tired right now. But I do try to keep things upbeat here because there's enough suffering going on without me adding to it. Why even mention it? I don't know, I needed the Word of Wednesday. You think this is easy? Realism?
You think this is easy? Realism?
Just wanted an excuse to quote some David Bowie there. Oh, and since I'm playing the world's tiniest violin right now, shameless self-promotion, the images that I'm coloring the background of Karen, and I have a couple other things that I threw up there, but they're now available on my Redbubble shop, link down in the description. Okay, let's get this show on the road. We're starting with non-comic related questions, and I'm gonna go into some questions about the revamp of Dark Horse, and then I got some questions regarding Ceremony, which is the act that we're on over on Comic Fury. So, first question. When can we expect the BitChute channel to start uploading? Yeah, I've been talking about BitChute and I haven't got shit up there. I'm a shiftless ass, so it's created, but I haven't had time to put any videos up there. Well, it's not that I haven't had time to put videos up there. It's that I don't want to put videos up there until I have created my introduction video explaining why that channel exists and how some of my references aren't going to make sense because I'm referencing things on YouTube that aren't uploaded onto BitChute. Haven't got the visual part done because I accidentally deleted the audio that I'd already edited, and with all the stuff for February that was coming due, I just haven't had time to re-edit the shit that I stupidly deleted. Like, I threw it in the trash bin, and then I emptied the trash bin, and then it was like, fuck, like right after, and we couldn't recover it. I hope to have it ready, probably not by the end of February, but hopefully in March, I hope. I'm starting to kind of get caught up. How do you decide upon your background? This is a hard question to answer because I'm really disorganized. Like, sometimes I'm organized and sometimes I'm not. So let's try to make something that actually is cohesive and makes fucking sense. Comic-wise, I try to keep a few things in mind. First, I try to remember that the viewer needs to have an anchor every now and then, reminding them of what the background is, what the setting is, the environment, where the characters are. They need that context every now and then. So for that, I make sure to have the setting actually in the background here and again. Of course, and when it changes, if they've moved from one location to another, which I've been doing in the revamp, you can see they're kind of walking through the forest as they're talking to Yuli instead of just standing around, which they had been doing. So I try to keep that in mind. Another thing that I take into account is mood, because I don't want the background every time. One, I don't have time, but also the background doesn't always convey mood or emotions. So I have to sometimes ask myself, what am I trying to get across? For that, I will sometimes reference pages in the manga that I like and kind of look at what they're doing, because obviously my comic is inspired by manga and that's been absorbed into Western culture fairly well, so most people, if I'm using those influence, most people who are attracted to my comic, I am assuming, are also, you know, familiar with some of those mood signals that are found in manga. But I also use things that I just kind of, my own little tropes that I like to throw in there from time to time. And for that, I'll either use screen tones, or more recently I've been trying to use my own inking talents, skills. A lot of that I'm kind of picking up from the Alfonso Dunn book that I bought and talked about in another video. So I've been trying to work on my inking, so that's one thing that I'll do. And screen tones, of course. I think I mentioned that. I don't fucking know. I'm disorganized. And for the pinups and character images, that I'm a flaming dumpster fire when it comes to backgrounds with those. Sometimes I have a definite idea of what I want to do, like with this fan art piece for Witches of the Evening. I already knew what I wanted to do for the background, and I just kind of played around with things to finish up with the coloring. You know, with my business card, which is in my branding that you see in my opening video, the little intro, with the ink drops, I had that pattern in mind because that's the medium that I predominantly work in. So sometimes I have an idea of what I want in the background, but other times I have no fucking clue. So I'll play around with different shapes and filters in Photoshop. Or if I'm like totally clueless, I will check out YouTubers like Drawing with Waffles, and other people who like do characters and sometimes want to throw a background in there. I will turn to them for inspiration, as I did with this image of Rin. I sure shit didn't come up with that on my own. I definitely did take influence, and yeah, so sometimes you just gotta kind of look around or play around, and I suck at backgrounds still, so don't look to me as an example for anything. Look to other more professional people, please. Okay, so next question. What do you listen to when you work? A variety of stuff. It's always changing. Well, it's not always changing, but it kind of depends on my mood. Sometimes my partner and I, we have a bedroom and we have an apartment area that we share, so we have a stereo, so sometimes we'll throw on kdhx.org. online, we'll Bluetooth it to the speakers. And that's awesome because KDHX is one of my favorite stations. It's public radio, it's community supported music. It's not some corporate piece of shit telling everyone what to listen to. It's actual human beings, actual DJs who are picking the music, things that they like, things that are sent to them, things that they find. It's got a human touch. It's not corporate bullshit. And if you like corporate bullshit, that's fine, but I don't. Being bitch. I told you I've been in some kind of malaise recently, so I'm not gonna be all perky and happy in this video, and I'm sorry for that, but yeah, I'm sick of corporate bullshit. So yeah, KDHX is awesome. You can listen to them online and they play a variety of different things. They're St. Louis based, but they've got anything from Sleepy Time Americana to, you know, DJs playing choice cuts from the area, as they put it. You got people like Orlandez, who I love his fucking show. He plays a lot of funk and kind of jazz, that kind of sound. Sometimes they play music that's more country sounding. I think on Sundays, I don't really like country too terribly much. I'm very picky with what country I listen to. And then they also have shit like From the Hills, which is like anything from like, you'll hear something from India played next to something from Hungary, from Bulgaria, from Russia, from South America. It's just all kinds of, just all over the world. There's all kinds of stuff. So I highly suggest KDHX. Wow, I've spent a lot of time advertising. It's free, so go listen to it. Anyway, recently we've also been putting on the local Portland Jazz Station 89.1. So if you guys are watching and you're in this area and can pick that up, I like it. It's pretty enjoyable. Other times we'll switch to our vinyl collection. I got a lot of my mom's records. I got a lot of my own records that I've bought, some new, some old. I also play from my favorites list. It's very eclectic. There's thousands of songs on it. No, I will not be sharing it with you because it's my private account, but yeah, you'll get like genre whiplash because you'll have like K-pop or J-pop 1 second and then it'll go to something like, I don't know, the Beatles. I mean, it's just things that I like and I don't want to forget exist, so. And then other days I like to listen to and watch YouTubers while I'm working. Either art YouTubers or, you know, something educational, something to feed my head with. Or sometimes I watch just stupid shit. Like The Right Opinion because he's entertaining and I like to hear the T word because realism. Anyway, I'm subbed to like a billion people, so I've got a lot of choices, you know, a lot of different things to listen to, and I like to hear the opinions of various people so that I can, you know, take different things into account and I'm not just kind of in my own little bubble. Anyway, okay, let's get into the Dark Horse revamp questions. Will Karen ever find her brother? Is she still looking? Is he still missing? Yes, he's still missing. Yes, she is still looking on and off, but I can't answer will she ever find him because I don't know yet. I haven't decided, so I don't know. I can honestly say I do not know. We haven't seen much of her yet other than in the transition act. Transition is when we are introduced to her. But right now, she's got a lot of responsibility, and I can't really talk about why because it gets into spoiler territory. But we're going to be seeing her pretty soon on Comic Fury because we're starting to wrap up Ceremony, which means they're going to be moving to another setting. And that's all I'm going to say for people who are at the revamp. I don't want to spoil things for them. Next question is kind of a joke question, but I felt like answering it, so I'm going to read it. What the hell is Ren going to do with Yuli's glaive? Here's the page that's being referenced. I'll throw that up there. Serious answer? Probably just leave it propped up in her bedroom or lying around until her parents find it and confront her about joining some kind of group or something. Try to figure. They're not very, they don't pay, I mean, they pay attention to their kids, but her mom's got a real young daughter who's like 5, her, you know, Ren's younger sister, and then she's got a fucking son in college, so she's, it's hard to keep track of all the kids. Anyway, not serious answer. I was thinking she could use it as cosplay as Sailor Saturn or something, but she'd get kicked out because it's a real glaive, so no. Spoilers, please skip ahead to this timestamp that's floating somewhere in this video in the floating text, because I'm going to talk a bit about Ceremony. Nothing like real spoilery, but I'm going to talk about it. One of my longtime readers asked me, does the magic text mean anything in reference to this page, Shimiko? It's just a mantra to activate Shimi's little wheel of fate. Can you guess what the spokes stand for yet? Anyone who's been reading over there or who's been watching these videos for a bit, you may, if you've been paying attention and you've been around for a while, you might notice that the spokes, the number of the spokes change from time to time. That will become clear, even more clear later on, but yeah, that's just something I'm gonna throw out there. Pay attention to that thing. It's just her language. It means something, but it's just her language. I had more questions on the language because one answer leads to another question, which is good. I like that. Is the language she's speaking a full language? For this scene, Shimiko's opted to speak her native language. And it is a full language, obviously, for her. It's from her people who are from around the Sri Lanka area, but are obviously fey folks. So this is very clearly a fake language. It is not real. Now, have I constructed an entire language for her? No. Am I going to? No. I am not Tolkien. I am not capable of doing that. I know my limits as a writer, and that is it. It's so, I'm not, I just can't. Obviously, there are people who can do that, and I am not one of them, and I admire them. But I will go into a little bit about the influence. The aesthetic look was inspired by Sanskrit and Arabic. My first boss ever, outside of my dad, whom I used to go land surveying with. I was a land surveyor, but I suck with math, so I couldn't make a career of that. But anyway, my first boss was from, I'm pretty sure he was from Palestine, and his wife was from Jordan. Or that, I may have them flipped. It may be vice versa. But, you know, I worked there all throughout high school. As soon as I turned 16, I applied at this restaurant. And I became very close with the family. They were just really nice people. And we also had like a shared experience of when I was in high school is when 9/11 happened. And so, you know, people in the community knew he told everyone he was from Saudi Arabia, but people who knew him well enough knew that he was not from there. But we all had kind of this shared experience of kind of fearing backlash from the community, because the city I come from, while it is a state capital, is very, it has a history of racism. Fancy that. But yeah, so I got very close with this family, and I wanted, this is so stupid and personal, I mean, it's just a little fucking fake language that I threw in this comic, but I did it because for me, it's just a little nod to them. A lot of my life experiences stem from the kindness of this family and just how much they did for me. And so it doesn't mean anything to anyone else. But for me, I wanted to kind of give a little nod to them. And it's so fucking tiny, but that's what I'm doing. I should have probably had some fucking characters, but I'm short-sighted and stupid. So this is how I do it. Maybe eventually I will have some characters to pay homage to them. But yeah, anyway, I miss them a lot. As a side note, because I don't, can't, and won't create an entire language for Shimi, let's not pretend I'm skilled enough or patient enough to do that. I have been trying to handwrite her speech in the bubbles, and as I do that, I'm adding these little symbols, these little characters that aren't traditional to English. And that's my way of denoting that she's actually speaking in her language, which looks like this, but I'm translating it so that we, the readers, can actually understand it. They are all connected and they understand what she's saying in spite of this language barrier she's using, and that's because of magic. Oh, also, as one more side note that I have written here in my notes. I did create my own font for Dark Horse so that I don't have to hand letter everything. And I did so using the free version of a font creator website called calligrapher.com. If you don't want to hand letter your stuff, certainly if you can hand letter your stuff, that's fucking awesome. If you have the patience and the time and the, well, God, it's not even time. If you're skilled enough, you probably can fly through hand lettering, but I can't do that. So this isn't for you if you want to keep doing it by hand. But if you're someone who wants to have a unique font for your webcomic or your comic that you're working on, I highly suggest the free version of calligrapher.com. The hand-created font that I use, I just, you know, downloaded the template, uploaded it to their program, and then downloaded the font they created to my Mac. You could probably do it with the PC too, obviously. But yeah, I just thought I'd share that resource because it's free and it might be helpful to you who don't want to use Comic Sans or something like that. You don't want to get caught using a copyrighted font because it's easy to do. That's an option for you. That's a free resource for you. So I thought I'd share that. Okay, that's all the questions I've got to answer to this month. So I've got a question for you. What is your favorite language that is not your native tongue, and why? I mean, it can be your native tongue. You can answer this however the hell you want. If your favorite language is whatever language you speak, there's nothing wrong with that. But I love languages. I can't read or speak any of them fluently. I have taken Spanish and I have taken Japanese, but again, I can't really speak them fluently. But I think both languages are beautiful. And anytime I hear French, anytime I hear any other language, I like it. I like to read the subtitles and hear the actual language. Now, I'm not above listening to a dub. Dubs have their place, and I like dubs too, but personally, I tend to like listening to the original audio and then reading the subtitles so that I can kind of absorb the original language, even if I don't understand what the fuck they're saying, you know. But that's something I like to do. But yeah, I don't know that I can pick a favorite. Yeah, anyway, let's end this video because I'm rambling. Thank you all so much. Peace and love. Fare you well. And keep on trucking.